This is Duke University.
Oh, Grace and peace in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, and welcome to worship on this Sunday morning. A few special words of welcome are in order. Our guest preacher today is Dr. Lauren Winner. She is assistant professor of Christian spirituality at the Divinity School. And if her voice sounds familiar to you, it might be that you've heard her recently on National Public Radio talking about her latest book. We also welcome the Millbrook High School Madrigals. They come to us from Raleigh, and we are delighted to have them as our guest choir today and Dr. Winner as our guest preacher. Welcome back to students as well who are returning from spring break, and we'll have the chapel choir back in full form next week. One announcement to lift up from your bulletins: there will be a crop walk information session today immediately following worship in the chapel kitchen. So if you're interested in the crop walk and learning more about it, please feel free to join that session. Now please stand as we lift our voices to God with the opening hymn.
Thank you. our Lord Jesus Christ said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself." Which of us can say we have kept these commandments? Therefore, let us confess our sins and ask to be made God's companions again. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Filled with the peace of Christ, let us share God's peace with one another.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Eternal God, who speaks to us in your will, give us insight to discern your will for us, to give up what harms us, and to seek the perfection we are promised in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Old Testament lesson is from Exodus, the 20th chapter. Then God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents to the third and fourth generations of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. For 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. This is the word of the Lord.
The gospel lesson is from John, the second chapter. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you would raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. In the name of the triune God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. So that you are not sitting on the edge of your pew wondering what this sermon is about, I will tell you. It is about the first letter of the first word of the first of the Ten Commandments. That is the letter aleph. You have an aleph in your bulletin decorating my name in the about the preacher box. If you need to refresh your visual memory of what an aleph looks like, you have two, actually, in that box. It looks a little like the letter X, or a little like a dancing woman, her hands in the air, maybe holding tambourines as she spins around. Or some have said that the aleph is the image of a human face. The long slash in the middle is the nose, and the two curving commas on the left and right are eyes. The aleph also happens to be the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet, so in that way, it is a little like our letter A. But it is unlike A at the level of sound, for the letter A makes a sound, or rather, it makes many sounds. It makes the long sound of ape and ache and amen, and the short sound of black lab. Linguists say that if you have the right accent, if you are a long-ago, old-time New Englander, then the letter A can call forth up to 9 sounds from your throat. The letter aleph, by contrast, is silent. The English alphabet has no silent letters, but Hebrew has 2, and one of them is aleph. Aleph sounds like this. That is the first letter of the first word of the first commandment, aleph. So here is what happened that morning at Mount Sinai. The people had been praying and cleansing themselves and even abstaining from sex in preparation for some kind of great revelation. And when the day came, it came with thunder and with lightning, and with clouds so thick it was like heaven itself had dropped down around the mountain. And Moses gathered the people at the foot of the mountain. He gathered the men and the women and all the children. And if the thunder and lightning weren't enough, other miraculous things began to happen, such as the wombs of pregnant women were turned transparent, so that their not yet born babies could witness the revelation for themselves and decades later tell their great-grandchildren that they had really and truly been there. Also, a little less miraculously, but still unusual, a trumpet sounded. And the people gathered, trembling, and they looked up to the mountain, and the first thing God said was aleph. The Decalogue represents God's greatest revelation to Israel in the Hebrew Scriptures. Nowhere in the Old Testament is God's will for us shown more clearly than in the Ten Commandments. Today, we often acknowledge the Ten Commandments even as we minify them. We do this by invoking the Decalogue without really engaging it. So we will happily, heatedly debate the propriety of posting the Ten Commandments in a courtroom. We read books with titles like The Ten Commandments of Dating, and we check websites called The Ten Commandments to Decorating Your Home and The Ten Commandments of Dog Ownership. These eponymous gestures simultaneously highlight the commandments and evade them. The Ten Commandments of dog ownership genre is easy to mock, but actually our countless 21st century variations on a Ten Commandments theme point to something important about the Decalogue. That is, the Decalogue has been enduring and essential in part because it encapsulates an entire ethos in memorable, pithy form and in authoritative, direct and directive language. When we stop to listen to the actual Ten Commandments, not the Ten Commandments of Uzo, phlebotomy, or yoga, but the actual Ten Commandments from the actual book of Exodus, when we stop to listen to those, what we hear is liberation. Liberation is not all we hear, but it is the bass note. It is the root of the chord. These 10 injunctions tell us about the kind of people we are free to be now that God has liberated us from Egypt. Now that God has liberated us, we are free to rest. We are free to live honorably and peaceably with our families. We are free to be a people that does not exploit or murder or steal. We are free to become one another's friends and the friends of God. The Ten Commandments will thread through the rest of Scripture, and reading on, we see how over time the Decalogue is both expanded and made more exacting to better and more precisely shape our life with God. So just a few verses after God first prohibits stealing, that commandment is shown to apply to the theft of people. Israel is not to kidnap. And later on in the Pentateuch, the Sabbath commandment is shown to extend beyond Saturday rest to sabbaticals and jubilees. Indeed, the fourth commandment animates an entire economics, an economics keyed to limits, to the goodness of land, labor, and person, and to the common good. At the same time that the reader is learning all that the Ten Commandments might encompass, she is also shown what ignoring the Decalogue can mean. Keep reading, and you will see what happens when David covets his neighbor's wife, and when Ahab covets his neighbor's vineyard. So these 10 words will ever after thread through Israel's life. They are strong thread, buttonhole thread, and they have the potential to hold us fast to God. God began that most important revelation of those most important commandments with an aleph, a silent letter. You have noticed, no doubt, that we do not live in a silent world. We live in a world full of sound. Some of the sound is glorious. Some of it is music or the sound of kindness, the sound of justice or love. And some of the sound is noise. OSHA, the federal agency charged with overseeing workplace safety, OSHA requires that any workers using a tool that emits an average of 85 decibels, those workers have to wear ear protection. It is worth noting that many children's toys emit 85 decibels, 90 decibels, 100. The Dora Magic Adventure Wand and the Road Ripper's Rush and Rescue Fire Truck are as loud as some lawnmowers. So your hearing might actually be safer at a construction site than inside a classroom at your child's daycare center. Restaurants are another noisy spot, and it's no accident that they are. It turns out that when the human body hears loud noise, we begin to crave other kinds of overstimulation as well. So you will eat more salty food when you are listening to loud music. And restaurant goers drink 30% more alcohol when the music is loud. So restaurants that want to run up our tabs crank up the volume. If you're like me, the noisiest thing of all is your own inner chatter. Noisier than your grandchildren's toys is the inner prattle, the inner narrator telling you true things and false things, alternatively focusing your attention and turning your head. If you're like me, that voice is the loudest thing of all. That morning at Mount Sinai, God's aleph silenced the inner chatter. God's aleph silenced the thunder. It silenced the trumpets. The aleph silenced the people's trembling and the people's shakes. God began the revelation at Mount Sinai with silence so that for once we could hear what God was saying. Rabbi Abahu said in the name of Rabbi Yochanan, when God gave the Torah, no bird twittered, no fowl flew, no ox lowed, none of the Ofanim stirred a wing. The seraphim did not say, holy, holy. The sea did not roar. The creatures spoke not. The whole world was hushed into silence. And then the voice went forth, I am the Lord your God. It was the only time God ever spoke to the people like that. God never again did that, call us all together and clap some thunder and sound trumpets and speak like that. In writing about the letter aleph, Rabbi Lawrence Kushner has pointed out that although you teach kids in Hebrew school that the aleph is a silent letter, really it's a little more complex. Really, the aleph is a glottal stop. If you open your mouth and start to make a sound and stop, that stop is the sound of aleph. So it is silent, but it is a particular kind of silent. It is the non-sound, the silent sound that precedes the making of all other sounds. It is the non-sound you have to say before you can say anything else. It is the non-sound that makes speech and conversation possible. So in speaking that silent aleph, God did more than just still the interfering noise. God also created the conditions for speech, for God's own speech, and also for Israel's speech. In other words, at Mount Sinai, God began a conversation which helps us remember that revelation is not just about the giving of decrees. It is also the quickening of a relationship. And yet, having quickened that relationship, never again did God call the people together and talk to them in those direct and revelatory terms. Sinai was the only time. Which might be a cause for despair, only it's not. For God gave and gives still many ways for us to hear God's voice. Scripture, of course, is one of the places where now, in these post-Sinai years, where we are not called to mountain bottoms in awe and trembling, we can still hear God speak. And the scriptures themselves tell us about places even beyond scripture where we may still hear from God. So for example, in Psalm 19, which I confess I thought we were reading collectively today, but you can read it this afternoon at home when you are practicing your Sabbath meditations. In Psalm 19, we read about the cosmos, the world, and we read about God's commandments. And what we read in Psalm 19 is the suggestion that we hear the same things from the cosmos and from the commandments, or at least we hear something awfully similar from commandment and cosmos. So the psalmist tells us that just as the sun illumines the earth, so too the commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. And the psalmist tells us that just as nothing can hide from the heat of the sun, so too a sinful person's transgressions cannot be hidden from the Lord. It seems from this psalm that the kind of truths we can know about God from the commandments, we can also know those truths from the wordless praise that creation continually sings to and about God. So God may not call us to the mountain with a trumpet anymore, but we can still hear God's voice in the very mountains themselves. And we can also hear God from one another. Remember how the aleph looks like a face, a nose, and two eyes? So picture this. There at the base of Mount Sinai, God's voice went forth and the people heard what they heard, and then God finished speaking, and the people uncricked their necks, and they turned their gaze away from the mountain. And just as the sea began clearing its throat to roar again, and just as the Ophanim began unfurling their wings, just as the Seraphim began to take up their holy holies, just as the fowl began thinking once more about flight, just then the people looked at one another, and they saw the aleph that they had just heard, the aleph of God, imprinted on the faces of their neighbors. And they knew that ever after, this too was a way they could hear from God. So on those days when God seemed very far away and silent, on days when cracking open a Bible just didn't seem possible, days when instead of wordlessly singing God's glory, nature seemed to be standing around with its arms crossed, on those days, maybe a woman would be having what she thought was an ordinary conversation with her neighbor about a recipe, say, or perhaps about the upcoming presidential election. And maybe down the street, two colleagues in an office were talking about their weekend plans. And maybe in a classroom across town, a teacher was telling his first graders about subtraction. These were just ordinary conversations on a day when God was far away. And lo and behold, unexpectedly, in that discussion about whether or not it was a good idea to double the muffin recipe, our two neighborly women actually heard from God. And lo and behold, unexpectedly, the co-workers plotting their weekend outings heard from God. And lo and behold, while discussing how many apples were left over if you took away two, the teacher and his students heard from God. That is part of the promise of the aleph, that you can look at the eyes and nose of your neighbor's face. You can look at the face of your husband or your teacher or even the person sitting next to you in the pew this morning, whom maybe you haven't even met yet. You can look into her face and you can hear God speak.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Liberating Lord, you brought your people out of slavery in Egypt and offered the gift of your law. Grant freedom to follow your commandments today and create delight in doing your will. Keep your people steadfast in devotion and increase the joy that comes in worshiping only you. Thread your word through our lives and let us covet in our neighbors those things that draw us closer to you. Break the bonds that oppress people today. Free those held captive by grief and disappointment. Release the grip of economic bondage and provide meaningful employment for any who seek work. Strengthen all who are engaged in preventing human trafficking and return child soldiers to places of safety and care. Send your justice and a spirit of peace to those places weakened by war. God of first things, you revealed yourself to the Israelites in awesome silence. Amplify the inner silence that reflects your peace, and teach us to hear your voice and see your face in unexpected people and places. In a moment of silence, we lift up a situation that needs your quiet, calming touch. Lord, in your mercy. Disruptive God, your Son entered the temple and turned the tables on those present. Overturn the obstacles in our lives that stand in the way of building fulfilling relationships. Drive out the things that distract and detract from following you. Pour out your love on any who feel unworthy of your affection. Be with the people of Japan who've struggled to reconstruct their lives in the year following the tsunami. Rebuild families and fortunes in this country that have been destroyed by tornadoes and floods. Compel your people everywhere to give freely of themselves and make our lives worthy sacrifices in praise of you. Lord, in your mercy. Reconciling Spirit, move throughout the world and bring relief to any wrestling with private grief, sorrow, or anxiety. This morning, we lift up the Department of Counseling and Psychological Services. We celebrate its dedication to serving the Duke community through deep care for those struggling with various forms of brokenness. Use its staff to help students find wholeness and healing in mind, body, and spirit. Comfort any who suffer from depression, loneliness, and quiet desperation. Watch over students, faculty, and staff returning from spring break and bring them all back to campus safely. Sustain our spirits through the remainder of this semester and renew efforts to proclaim your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, help us to hear your word and obey it so that we may become instruments of your redeeming love through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. This week's undesignated offerings go to support human service organizations in Durham. Let us honor our neighbors and spread God's good news by sharing the gifts that God has given.
Ministers will be in the memorial chapel to my right during the sharing of communion. If you've come this morning with an issue heavy on your heart, they'll be glad to pray with you. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Covenanting Lord, you made this world and us to be your companions. And in Moses, you showed us the spirit of freedom and the freedom of your spirit. On Sinai, you showed your people how to keep their freedom and walk in your spirit. You called Israel to be a priestly kingdom and a holy nation. In your temple, you enshrined your law and made your mercy seat the place of your people's reconciliation with you. And then in Jesus, you came among your people as the embodiment of your law and the personification of your temple and the emblem of your freedom. And so we gladly thank you with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, singing the hymn of your unending praise. Righteous God, your Son said, destroy this temple and in 3 days I will raise it up. And here we gather before you to lament the agony of that destruction and to celebrate the glory of that raising up. Come into the temple of this your body, that your people may become a temple of your presence, and that these gifts of bread and wine may be for us the body and the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, who at supper with his disciples took bread, gave you thanks, broke the bread, and gave it to them, saying, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup. Again, he gave you thanks and gave it to his disciples, saying, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Great is the mystery of faith. Merciful Father, in your commandments we see the simplicity and the sacrifice of our life with you and your life with us. Make us holy as you are holy. Raise up saints from this community and make us quick to recognize the saints we encounter elsewhere. Fill our hearts with prophetic zeal for your house, for your holiness, for your kingdom, and for your grace. Take out of your church the idolatries that grieve you, and fill your church with a transparency of heart that honors you. Until the day when all sin is transformed by your grace, all scarcity suffused with your abundance, and all disorder healed by your mercy, and you are all in all, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. In the anger at our sin and the never-ending love for all creation, we see the broken heart of God. We destroyed this temple, but behold, here it is raised up. Come and be filled with the zeal of God's love. God only wise, you delight to make your people out of food, and the food out of which you make us is your body and blood. As we have become your body in the eating of food, bless those with whom we share food this week, and bless those with whom we share you, and in whom we meet you, that in being made your body, we may become food for your world, and through the change they see in us, all may come to praise the glories of your name. Amen. Christ, give you grace to grow in holiness, to deny yourselves, to take up your cross, and to follow him. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.